Hello and welcome to Hazard and Hope. I'm Ed, and in this episode we're going to be looking at the Code of Practice for Property Flood Resilience. I'm going to be talking about what it is, who made it, why it's been created, and the process and key principles that are set out within it. So here we go. This episode of Hazard and Hope is sponsored by Yorkshire Flood Resilience. So first things first, what is Property Flood Resilience, or PFR? Well, it's accepted as an approach that can help to lessen the impacts of flooding on a property, and the guidance defines this as including measures that provide a way to reduce the risks to people and property, enabling households and businesses to reduce flood damage, speed up recovery, reoccupation of flooded buildings, and potentially obtain insurance cover more easily and more affordably. Now, flood risk is obviously managed in a variety of different scales and ways, but PFR is particularly pertinent in areas in which it may not be possible to protect communities using structural flood defences, and in those places where there's a risk that existing structures could well be overtopped or even breached. So what is the Code of Practice for Property Flood Resilience? Well, it's guidance that sets out a process and benchmark through which property flood resilience should be specified and deployed. And it primarily relates to physical measures that can be introduced to properties that are at risk of flooding. So why is it needed? Well, first and foremost, with the frequency and severity of flood events increasing as a result of climate change, we need to adapt our existing building stock to be more flood resilient and also ensure that new properties are designed to the right standards and won't be vulnerable or exposed to flood risk. The challenging issue for the industry as a whole has been that there has to date been a lack of consistency in the way in which property flood resilience has been implemented. And that inconsistency can lead to varying results with regards to the quality and ultimately hamper the progression and wider recognition of the value and effectiveness of PFR. Now, there are many great examples and success stories of ways in which people have implemented property flood resilience. And you can see some fantastic examples in the Our Flood Resilient Home and Our Flood Resilient Business episodes of Hazard and Hope. But there needs to be more consistency about the way in which PFR is assessed, delivered, installed, and maintained over time. The ambition and, I suppose, expected benefits of the Code of Practice are really that it can help to provide a structured approach to the application of PFR to help reduce the chance of measures being poorly specified and installed. But also the hope is that it can provide more confidence to property owners and to the insurers that PFR will lessen the impacts of flooding on their buildings. The Code of Practice was officially launched in February 2020 with an update and more detailed guidance released in January 2021. It was funded over a period of 3 years by the Environment Agency, Welsh Government, Northern Ireland Department for Infrastructure, Scottish Government and Aviva, as well as being endorsed and supported by SIWEM, ICE and RICS. Here you can see the diverse range of partners that came together to actually deliver the project. And that included the project steering group of 55 members, of which it was a pleasure to be part of. And really the engagement with that steering group enabled input from a diverse range of stakeholders, from industry and academia, and both the public and private sector. This guidance has been developed in the context of the UK, but I think it makes for an excellent precedent for other countries that may be interested to work with or from it. But in terms of the audience that it's intended for, it's been designed for use and to relate to a diverse range of different individuals and stakeholders. So as you can see here, there's really a broad remit from property owners to designers and contractors, right the way through to policymakers, planners and insurers. And whilst not every one of these will need to dive into the deepest, most techie detail, it is important that there's an engagement and broad understanding of what the Code of Practice entails, as it'll enable a much more consistent approach through the industry and society as a whole as to how we make communities more flood resilient. Now, the code has been developed to be applicable to both new build as well as existing contexts. In terms of the property type, it's not just intended for residential buildings, it also applies to non-domestic buildings, and it can also be used in relation to the design and adaptation of multiple properties as well as individual ones. In terms of the overarching structure of the Code of Practice, it's set up around 6 distinct standards, and those fall into 3 phases, which are design, construction, and operation. Now, in this episode, we're giving a general overview of the setup, process, and purpose of the Code of Practice, but we'll be bringing out more detailed episodes on each of the individual PFR standards, stages, and steps in due course. For each standard, there's a specific aim and set of requirements. Now, the way in which the requirements of each of these different standards is achieved is through the PFR process. And this process is set up around six stages, which relate to the six PFR standards. Each stage has a number of steps which should be followed to move through the PFR process and enable the various requirements of each of the different standards to be achieved. So the first stage in the process is the hazard assessment. Now the purpose of this is that it helps to build up a detailed understanding of the likelihood and the consequences of flooding from different sources for a given context. And the first step here is to actually identify and assess the sources of flooding. Now this process can include referencing and reviewing historical, community, and individual knowledge of flooding. And then step two is to identify the actual pathways through which water arrives at and can enter the property. Then the third step is to understand the actual likelihood of flooding at that given location. And the information gathered and analysed from these steps will then be used to help inform the suitability of potential PFR measures. Then the next stage is the property survey. Now this helps to assess the current level of flood resilience in the property. It provides information for the detailed design of PFR measures and can also help to bring together and collate some of the different end user requirements. So the first thing to consider here is actually proportionality, because essentially the scale and detail of the survey needs to be appropriate for the context, budget, and end user needs. The next step actually looks at assessing the property and defining its key attributes and characteristics. So that can include things like the house type, construction material, its age, condition, and different thresholds and floor levels. We then need to look at the needs of the actual end user themselves and what the existing levels of resilience are in the property. And if drying and decontamination are required, then any survey needs to identify the appropriate methods and process by which these are undertaken. And the last step in stage two of the property survey is to understand the ground conditions. So by the end of the survey process, you'll have stages one and two complete. You should then have a really rigorous and detailed understanding of the flood risk context and the property setup. And then the next stage is options development design, so seeing what you can do to adapt. Now in terms of approaches to PFR, it's important to understand the terminology and types of approaches for property flood resilience that the code sets out. So flood resilience is defined as the capacity that people, groups or structures may possess to withstand or recover from a flood. Property flood resilience is really an overarching kind of general term within which we have flood resistance and flood recoverability. And there are distinct differences between these two approaches. So flood resistance relates to the use of materials and approaches to manage water entry into the property. And it relates to water exclusion, so essentially keeping water out. An example of that might be something like a flood door. But it's important to point out that resistance-based approaches aren't going to be suited for every construction type or flood risk context, and that their performance is reliant on them being correctly specified, fitted, managed, and maintained. So that's resistance, but flood recoverability relates to the use of materials, products, and construction methods that prevent the internal fabric of the property from being unduly damaged by floodwater and allow it to recover quickly after a flooding. So that could be changing the wall or floor finishes so that they're materials which don't swell or distort when they come in contact with floodwater. So essentially the property itself can be more easily recovered. Now taking a step back, as well as resistance and recoverable approaches, there are also avoidance-based approaches for PFR. That could include things like raising your floor levels or repositioning habitable areas. So there are a range of different options out there that you might consider, but it's also really important to bear in mind things like the lifetime requirements, indicative costs, and actually how the strategy relates to the specific end user preferences. The PFR strategy is then defined and different responsibilities assigned. And at this point, we've reached the end of the design phase, which is the first phase of the three phases of the code of practice. Next, we have the construction phase, and really that's what stage four focuses on. And this part of the PFR process is about ensuring that the property is designed or adapted in a way that's in accordance with regulations and up to standard. So the contractor would review the design and specification, and then it's about getting agreement from all of the different parties on the proposed property flood resilience design and it being set out in a contract. And then the works can get underway and PFR measures can be installed. The fifth stage in the PFR process is the actual commissioning and handover. And really what happens in this stage is a kind of quality control check of sorts, you know, during which time you might have a post-installation audit to be sure that the PFR measures have been fitted and operate as intended, and that the relevant parties have the information that they require to implement and maintain the different measures. And if this is all in order, then these works can be signed off. We then get to the final stage, which is operation and maintenance. So this is about the way in which end users actually use their handover pack, find suitable places to store and access their PFR measures, maybe undertake and record maintenance activities, and assess how measures are used and perform in the event of a flood. And then that is the PFR process, 1 to 6. So as you can see, it encompasses the full range of design, construction and operation, but really there are a number of key principles that underpin the code of practice. And crucially, it highlights competence. So it does say that, you know, all aspects of the PFR process should be undertaken by an appropriate person who will act in accordance with a relevant set of professional standards. And this or these professional persons must also act impartially during the process. So they're not allowed to favour any particular supplier, equipment, materials or services. But as I mentioned earlier, the code also points out that any PFR specification needs to be proportional. So if, for example, you have a home that's at quite low risk of flooding, then it could be that a less detailed survey is required. So you might not need that full kind of forensic investigation. But at the same time, if you have a property that's at potentially quite high risk of flooding, then a very detailed analysis of that flood risk context and a survey of the building can be vital in helping develop a suitable PFR strategy. Now, when it comes to procurement of property flood resilience, the code doesn't prescribe any specific procurement routes as such, but it does show a range of different types of approach and some of the different factors to consider with each. In England, the Environment Agency has their collaborative delivery framework, on which they have a number of pre-appointed preferred suppliers that have been identified as being competent across a range of lots. But like anything, it's important to understand the scope and remit of different types of guidance and the topics and themes that the code of practice does not cover. Okay, so it does not cover the use of strategic flood defences, doesn't cover community flood barriers, it doesn't cover sustainable drainage systems or SUDs. Really, it's focused on and around flooding specifically at the property level, but that excludes floods that might occur from leaks in plumbing systems or via things like defective roofs and gutters. There are aspects and, I suppose, strategies within the guidance that can relate to these different elements, but it's not been specifically set up to consider those. At this moment in time, there also isn't an agreed industry standard measure of flood resilience for both products and properties, so it doesn't allow any generic guarantees to be provided in relation to the performance of PFR. But it does note that certain products can themselves have performance guarantees and be certified to conform to BSI standards. So in those cases, the warranties and performances of those will relate to their specific use and the contract set up and agreed in each individual circumstance. In terms of the supporting information for the code of practice, there's the detailed guidance, but there's also a homeowner and business guide that's been released and a guide for local authorities and planners that's coming soon. So where can you find the code of practice? Well, it's free to download from Syria's website. You just need to register, and I've put the link in the description just below this video. But really, whichever industry or background you're approaching this topic from, I think the code of practice really is an important piece of guidance to be up to speed on, and I suppose the more that we can get a consistent process into the way in which we work in this field, then there should be a much greater uptake in the quality and quantity of properties that are made flood resilient. And ultimately, that's going to have a significant impact on helping many people adapt to flood risk, you know, reduce recovery times and minimise the devastating impacts that floods can cause. So spread the word about the code of practice for property flood resilience. And if you're watching this from the UK and your property is at risk of flooding and you want to make it more resilient, please just do check that any professionals you engage with on designing or adapting your property follow the specific steps, stages and standards that the code of practice sets out. So thanks very much for listening. And if you'd like to keep updated on future episodes, please subscribe below, hit the bell for notifications, and we'll look forward to seeing you soon.